Good morning and welcome to a SAP community call with our very special guest, Thomas Zawiesek. We're here again, and that's really exciting for me to say and very much appreciated on the side of the SAP community that you were taking the time, Thomas. Welcome to the call. How are you?
No, very good so far, and I hope everybody's also safe and healthy in these very unprecedented times. And as you said, Craig, I mean, great to be back and always a great pleasure to get into conversation and engagement, to learn from your questions. So really excited. Yeah.
And folks, like last time, I'm going to give Thomas a few minutes to just talk a little bit, but then we're going to go right into a Q&A. You have the opportunity to ask your question in the Q&A tool. If you do it in the chat, we'll try to make sure we capture it. If the chat's not too crazy or anything like that, then you know we'll be able to do the chat as well. Or you can actually even come off mute, raise your hand, come off mute, and ask your question directly if you like. So the choices are yours, and we will do our best to answer everything that we can. So with that, Thomas, I'll turn it over to you for a few minutes, and then we can jump right into it.
No, thank you very much, Craig. And as you mentioned, let's keep that really brief and short, because the most value is actually exactly the engagement with you, the questions you have, and really to address your needs. And I think that's also how we spend the time most valuable for you. So thanks for having me again. I really appreciate it. And I'm quite frankly also glad that we found a good mode between the Americas time zone and the APJ time zone. So I think that's also very important. And also, let me start actually before I go into the product strategy, which is for sure dear to my heart. But actually, what is even more important for me is that we are still in these very unprecedented times, and basically the health of everybody from the community, our partners, customers, and for sure employees is on top of my mind. And here again, as I mentioned, I hope that you are safe and healthy, and especially as it's also in the APJ time zone. For instance, in India, we have a very serious situation still. Unfortunately, we still see growing numbers, and I can rest assured that also from our side, for sure, we do whatever we can. I, for instance, have a regular also meeting with our leadership team in India, and it's actually quite phenomenal how the team actually is really going through that crisis situation together. So also here, big thank you to Sindhu and the entire team in India, a phenomenal job. And I just want to also hear to everybody in the call, I wish you safe, and let's get through that together in these very, very critical times. From a product strategy perspective, I mean, the good piece with the strategy is that it should be consistent for quite some time, but execution should be for sure agile, and we should move. And I think that's hopefully what you actually recognize with SAP. And actually that last year we really evolved our strategy. And this is where you hopefully see the consequent execution this year. And I think I'm very proud if I think about the progress we did with regards to the integration activities. We updated also the integration roadmap and the paper. And I hope that also the customers will feel the change of what we deliver by that, because that is also foundation for a lot of innovation actually, which we now can deliver based on the work we did last year. And I think that's exciting. And certainly Sapphire is around the corner. And you rest assured that there will be a lot of announcements with regard to the progress we did with that topic, but really actually how we also want to take it higher, the innovation. And I think that's a very important aspect, because fundamentally what we want to do is really to help customers really to reinvent themselves and the businesses in the future. And we all know that even past this pandemic, I mean, the mindset and the business model will have significantly changed. And we want to be exactly those trusted partner who walks along the line. And that's also a reason why when you think about the activities we started last year with the doubling down on sustainability, I think it's fair to say that at Sapphire we will announce actually products around product footprint management, around circular economy, responsible design actually, and production, to really help to really close the loop. And that will be all kind of a firework of innovation this year around really making that real. If you think about the ESG dimensions for sustainability, that we will be able to provide you with a dashboard to really manage that end to end across all the aspects, because for sure sustainability is more than also, for instance, the carbon footprint. It's also about the societal impacts like diversity and inclusion. And what better than to have diversity and inclusion naturally embedded in success factors? And that's what we actually do and help our customers along the way. Really also thinking about what is the purpose of enterprise software. And there we actually spend a significant amount of time to really embed sustainability as a key aspect of how businesses should be run. And quite frankly, I fundamentally do believe we shouldn't have a separate sustainability strategy. Actually, we should have a business strategy, which is sustainable. And this is also a mindset change, which we should have. We should not only purely think about financial dimensions of success, but really also adding kind of to the top and the bottom line, also a green line to the success of our customers. So sustainability will be a big thing also at Sapphire. Also thinking about the purpose of enterprise software is we need to connect the dots way better. I mean, we proudly have more than 400,000 customers who trust SAP. And we have the largest network on earth with our SAP business network. But I think we absolutely, and we will absolutely double down to make every application network aware and to bring all of our networks, which we have together under one umbrella with the SAP business network. And you will hear more announcement around this and what we concretely do at Sapphire. But I think the notion around network is super critical for us because we are actually in a networked world. This is a reality, but I think we still live in processes which are more point to point from a customer to a supplier and the supplier to the next supplier. And then you have these N tiers of suppliers which are connected point to point instead of having the full visibility around the network and how to optimize it and the insights into that. And these are aspects which are super critical for us. So sustainability, network. And quite frankly, also at Sapphire, will be something what is dear to my heart, because that's actually how I started in the IT function at SAP. My journey was about mobile. And I think certainly also a topic we want to talk more together with you about what we do for mobile. And here we will certainly launch some activities to really mobilize our portfolio in a different manner at Sapphire as well. And here also very happy actually with Ben Lehnert, our new chief design officer, who is on board since January. And I hope you had some, perhaps already some connections to him. And if not, I actually would even recommend that we really do a separate community call, perhaps specifically for UX, because it's quite inspirational actually, how we want to evolve our user experience to the next level, really embracing new things. Like if you think about in the future, I mean, and the possibilities we have with AI, for sure, we should have enterprise software which is really then used in a way that you really only try for the exceptional processes, where you really need to have complex decision-making processes out of the norm, because everything which is in the norm should be anyway automated dramatically and standardized, which means really, because let's be honest, I mean, nobody wants to use enterprise software. You want to get your job done, and we need to help you to get your job done. And that's actually what we are there for. And this is something where I believe we need to rethink what we can achieve actually with situations. And you have first glimpses of that in S4 with the situation handling framework, embedding also AI to give you all the context. And that's for sure what we want to do across the portfolio. And I think that is a tremendous opportunity to rethink actually how the engagement with software actually looks like. So there's a plenty amount of possibilities here, what we have on our list. So Sapphire will be exciting. I think we have a good story to tell also with regards to how we want to evolve RISE with SAP. It was a tremendous success after the launch. For sure, there's always some questions and there's some open topics we need to get better and to enable our own colleagues at SAP, our partners and our customers better, for sure. But the success and the market momentum is huge, and that's the reason we definitely also want to double down on this activity even further at Sapphire. A lot to come. I think it will be, as I always mentioned, it will be a firework of innovation, which we will show. Really looking forward to that one, and for sure, would be great also to get your feedback then to that as well. I mean, one of the aspects, and I forgot to mention it in the beginning, is actually the notion around ecosystem, because I think what SAP and what we really try in the last quarters and years to really think differently about our ecosystem, and I once had a panel discussion with Cedric Neike from Siemens. He's the CEO of Digital Industries and the board of Siemens. And we have this strategic partnership with Siemens around, for instance, the area of the digital thread with the design, so the PLM aspect and how we embrace Siemens Teamcenter in our portfolio with an amazing integration to really connect the dots here on these regards. And we had a panel discussion. Actually, he made a great statement, which I sometimes like to quote. He called it, we need to go away from ego systems to ecosystems. And I think this is so well phrased. And this is where we also want to open up way more for partners, like you see with that partnership with Siemens, to really think differently about partnerships and be way more open to that. And that's also, if you think about our approach with the business technology platform, which is an open platform, which should invite actually startups, partners to really leverage our assets, what we have, and for sure also assets like our domain model, which we want to bring there, that you can more easily build applications, which are then integrated with the SAP backend systems as well, to make it simpler actually for that. So ecosystem is a big topic for us, and we definitely look forward to see way more of that. Yeah. Having said all of that, I mean, plenty of topics on the list. I mean, and here, just want to open up for Q&A and take all the possibilities, all the topics of SAP you have in mind. I'm here for you, and I'm happy to address every question you have on top of your mind. And again, thanks for participating and to take time together with me today for this session. So thank you very much.
It's a lot to take in, a lot of information, a lot of teasers about coming Sapphire, which I always like. It's interesting. You talk about the supply chain and everything like that. And we, you know, as a consumer, as an individual, you see YouTube videos and advertising videos of all these companies that are doing all this stuff with their supply chain and how they're making things more sustainable. But it's most likely companies like SAP who are actually enabling that to actually happen. And I guess that's just not the surface level of the story that you're hearing the most about, but it's really exciting to hear how much effort and extra effort that we're putting in to really make that possible. So I guess as you start to see all these companies advertise about how great their supply chain is becoming and how sustainable, one thing to remember is SAP may be in the background there. That is really cool.
Not only maybe, most probably most of the time, actually, in some sort or the other.
When we talk about the ecosystem and things like this, and you've talked quite a bit here now about sustainability, do you still see that as the important? I mean, a lot of companies have a lot of other problems at the moment. Is sustainability still that one of those major focus areas?
Absolutely. I mean, without a doubt. I even think, for sure, we saw last year that the pandemic is something which crashed basically every company, and every company need to focus very short term, again, as you mentioned, on supply chain and other aspects. So it's somewhat overshadowed for a couple of months, certainly the notion around sustainability. But absolutely, when I look around the world, actually, the regulations go up, the governmental activities around supply chain go up. There's a big vocal discussion about carbon tax on a global scale now, even what that means, actually. So way more on these discussions, but not only the governments are really more forcing now the topic of sustainability. And you see also, again, across the world, more commitment towards that topic. Mm-hmm. But also if you think about the investors and asset management companies like BlackRock, for example, very vocally will only invest in companies which have a carbon neutral plan. Otherwise, they don't even invest anymore in companies with this regards. If you think about your customer base, what we absolutely do see with our customers, and that's a very strong feedback we receive from our co-innovation partners, that the real end consumer is way more sustainability sensitive. And also with regards to the entire sourcing of the products, because they want to have ethical sourcing. They don't want to see any child work in between. And that's actually what we do with Ariba, by the way, to actually prevent that and to avoid that. So really helping our customers in this regards. But they absolutely want to know what is the product carbon footprint, actually, what they receive. And there's a statistics, and for sure, you know, there are many statistics, so I think it's not the detail about it, but basically in this statistic, it's mentioned more than 73% of the asked people actually say they would be even willing to pay an uplift of 35% of the price if they know it's an ethically sourced product and a carbon footprintless product, actually. So they are willing to even pay an uplift for these regards. And this is also something which is important. If you think about you see government focus on sustainability, investors and shareholders think about sustainability, consumers look at sustainability, absolutely. And we see that without a doubt, a trend in every industry. And then you also, quite frankly, think about your employees. The notion around purpose is different these days. And employees want to work for companies which really live up to a purpose to do something good for the world as well and want to get something better. And in the war of talent, quite frankly, if you cannot prove that you are on such a journey, you will not have the possibility to attract the best people. And this is what we will see more. So actually, also from employee base, there's a huge pressure on sustainability. And that's something what we see everywhere. So from our perspective, and quite frankly, we for the sustainability products, we specifically said we want to do that in co-innovation with customers. We actually, unfortunately, need to cut down the kind of request from our customers to become co-innovation customers because they were so many. So we needed to limit it because otherwise it would be too much and we could not focus. So the demand is huge. And you clearly see that coming back to the network aspect, if you want to make the circular economy real across, then exactly you need to tap into the network because what is for the one company, the output can be for the other company, the input. And this is something where I truly believe that especially the notion around the network is a key aspect to bring that actually together.
Yeah. Now, in regards to talent, we have a question that just popped in. I am Srinivas from India, and I did my MBA and have 10 years of experience in CRM, functional testing, Siebel, Salesforce. I like SAP brand a lot, and I worked in some of the project where it was used by other teams. Looking for an opportunity where I would like to do some business as channel partner, distribution, sales or service, or any small external entity, et cetera, abroad. I would like to explore new places too. Any guidance or program available from someone in SAP? For me, I read this as more along the lines of where can people find out about opportunities, whether it's with our customers, our partners, or even SAP? Where are we helping our customers to identify talent, such as Srinivas here?
Yeah, I mean, as I understand the question, I mean, if you have a question around how you get into the partner programs, the ecosystem, how you can leverage our tools, that you get some demo systems or development systems to work on, I mean, absolutely, let's absolutely reach out to our partner team. In case you don't know the partner team, feel free actually to shoot me an email, and I'm happy to connect you after that meeting to the right people personally. That's no problem at all. I'm here to help. So thanks for the question. I would love to make the connection. And as you laid out your experience with CRM, and that's for sure also something dear to my heart. I started my career at SAP in the CRM consulting area. So certainly something I would love to get in touch and to really see how we can drive that. Because also here on the customer experience portfolio of SAP, we have an absolutely focus on really how we can differentiate actually also with the assets we have in the combination of those assets. If you think about commerce and how we can actually differentiate by really bringing commerce together with the supply chain, with the information which you have in the back office to truly actually deliver not only a buying experience, which is phenomenal, but also a customer experience. And as you all know, for instance, in the commerce world, the customer experience doesn't end with the buy button on the store. I mean, this is a nice thing, but in the end of the day, if you don't get it delivered in time, in quality, and in the promised timeline, I mean, for sure. And by the way, the return process is a key aspect as well. So if that's not working, then your customer experience is broken. And just think about the return process for a second. And I'm very enthusiastic actually about that one, because if you think about the return process in this online world, it's actually phenomenal, because it sounds like such a boring process because you want to just send something back. Think about the complexity for a company behind the return process, because they need to judge, can I sell it as a first party product again? Do I need to sell it as second hand because it was opened and used? What does it mean from the characteristics of that one? And if you know about the return processes also, unfortunately, how much waste it will be produced, because some of the returns get actually destroyed, which is unbelievable. So in the return process itself, there's so much potential to optimize, actually. It's unbelievable. So sometimes, again, if you think about customer experience, this is really across the spectrum of what we want to achieve. And looking forward to the connection. I will help you to navigate through the partner world that you certainly get all the enablement material to really strive in that space.
Fantastic. And we actually have an attendee that would like to ask their question. So Emmanuel, I'm going to horribly pronounce your last name. I do apologize. Ukoha. So
yeah,
Emmanuel.
You're close. All right. Good morning. It's 9 a.m. here in Lagos, Nigeria. So my question is around capacity development. I'm already working with SAP. I work on SAP Business One. But recently, I've been going through some articles online trying to understand SAP HANA. That was when I was able to know that SAP has a target for 2025. That was the last article I read in migrating all customers to HANA. But yet, some articles I saw online was focusing on the perceived skill deficiency, that we don't have much technical consultants that really know how HANA works. So I want to ask, even here in Nigeria, we also face that. So I have a couple of questions. The first question I want to ask is, what is SAP doing to close the skill gap in the area of training for those who intend to learn about HANA? Then I know SAP Business One. I deploy SAP Business One. But if I want to learn about HANA as a tech consultant that is based in Nigeria, what are my options? Then my last question is, why put into consideration the economical disadvantage that we have from this side of the world? What is SAP doing to encourage people to embrace and learn about SAP technologies so that they can be useful in deployment? Because the skill gap sometimes is because people don't know how to get these trainings. So I would like to know what SAP is doing to encourage people to want to learn about this new technology. Thank you. That's my question.
Thank you very much, Emmanuel. I really appreciate it. And I had some slight drops in the connection, but I try to address all the questions. And if I misunderstood one question, please for sure correct me, and I will be happy to guide in the right direction then as well. But first of all, I mean, as I understood you with regards to Business One, I mean, they're also one of the important strategic activities. What we do with Business One is around the web client. This is certainly something which is on top of the list for this year on the portfolio. And certainly if something is missing here from a transparency about the roadmap for Business One and how we deliver now the web client, certainly something we can also follow up on, but this is for sure one of the most strategic activities here for our customers and partners. With regards to HANA and the skill topic which you raise in general for HANA, but also for SAP technology in general, this is something where we absolutely for sure have a huge interest to increase the spread of our knowledge and enablement across in all regions for sure and all industries. And for sure, we also want to start very early, like in the university and even in school, that people can already get first touch points with SAP and SAP software. There we now have a new chief learning officer since end of last year in place with Max Wessel. And he's also very actively working not only on massive open online courses, what we do from Open SAP and the likes, that you really can consume a lot of content for sure anyway for free, but also adding up our learning hub in certain target groups for free and give some topics here to really ensure that that this is getting better. And for sure, one of the key vehicles actually to drive knowledge transfer is for sure the community. So the SAP community itself and the forum we have there is for sure tremendous wealth actually of tremendous richness of experience, knowledge. So it's actually an unbelievable amount of expertise there. So also here, I believe also the network in the community will absolutely help you in all sorts of fashions around SAP. And I think that's also something where exactly now here, Craig and the team, and we are really looking forward to really see this community and how we help each other in this together. So that's with regards to learning and for sure I would need to look specifically what are in your region the specific approaches and campaigns we drive. But absolutely, it is for us key that knowledge and enablement is a key aspect, and for sure also the aspect about that should be for free, because the more knowledge we have in the in the community, and is the better for us for the implementation project and for the project overall. And now I know that I forgot your third question or didn't address your third question, but this was again, there was some drops in the line in between. So if you could reframe or if I misinterpreted your question, that would be good.
Okay, sorry. I think you got the answer. So I really appreciate it. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
No, thank you very much, Emmanuel. And let's stay in touch. And again, if there's anything what you miss, or again, feel free to reach out. Happy to connect you with some of the knowledge resources we have, and also perhaps to see that this is really coming. So thank you so much. Really appreciate it.
All right. Thanks. Thank you.
Staying in line with the educational, the next question is from Douglas. Thomas, I've happily been an SAP developer for the last 15 years, from ABAP to SAP UI5. How do you see SAP developers' careers being affected by low codes, AI, and other new technologies? And what new learnings do you suggest us to pursue for the future?
Oh, that's a very, very interesting and very deep question, actually, because I think this question has multiple dimensions. I mean, for sure, I mean, in technology, in IT, we all know technology is something which is evolving rapidly. The amount of change in technology is huge, absolutely. And so I, for sure, can always encourage everybody to really always be curious to learn something new and to continue to open up the horizon to different topics. It's absolutely critical. So first and foremost, that's very important. But also specifically, as you mentioned, low code and what impact that will have. I fundamentally do believe that actually for it, there will be also in the future more than sufficient, way more than sufficient need for really pro code developments, because there are certain highly complex topics which we solve where for sure you need more deep logic and algorithms which we need to bring to the table. So not everything can be done by low code and no code, by no means. If you think about some of the applications which we build from SAP or also our partners, the complexity of the topics we solve actually is something where for sure low code and no code will come to a certain barrier level, quite frankly. That's the reason why I would never worry about that low code or no code will take work away for those complex things. But it's absolutely true that the more digital competencies and digital literacy is anyway in the next generations which are coming up, that for sure also business users want to have more quickly possibilities to extend certain things in a very easy way, to have an additional field here and there, or to even in a very simple way create a small workflow to a colleague. And this is certainly something we also want to simplify for the business users. And as they again have more digital literacy also in the future, even more, there will low code, no code will play an important role to really do that. And we anyway don't have enough engineers in the world to solve all the problems we want to solve. And that's the reason why low code, no code is certainly an important aspect to just broaden actually the target group of people really trying to digitalize topics. But again, this will not limit the amount of work and actually the huge demand we have for highly skilled engineers to solve the world's biggest problems we actually do solve and want to solve. And this is something where this will not go away. From a technology perspective, you mentioned ABAP, you mentioned SAP UI5. And also what you see actually in this regards for enterprise software, enterprise software is certainly a longer time horizon, which is actually a positive in this regards as well. Because also today, we have too limited ABAP developers across the world. We have scarcity for ABAP developers, and also ABAP, as it's the foundation for S/4HANA, will be for the next 20 years center stage. So no worry about that. We even now embrace with Steampunk the ABAP runtime engine also in S/4HANA Cloud as the extensibility layer. So even for S/4HANA Public Cloud, and again more announcements around that will come at Sapphire, but that you basically also with S/4HANA Cloud, you can then basically use the open whitelisted APIs within the S4 core to really do developments in S4 Cloud, but in a clean way that we don't have any lifecycle impacts on the standard code. And there Steampunk will help us. So also you see in the cloud, ABAP will continue and will be a strategic asset as well for the ERP world of SAP. SAP UI 5 is the predominant UI technology for S4HANA. So also here, SAP UI 5 will last, it will not go away. While what we for sure also see on UI technology, you see something like React and others, which certainly have a huge pickup in different other applications. And depending on your preference, and if you want to be more a front-end UI developer and developer, for sure it's also interesting to look into some other technologies for other aspects as well. But also UI5 will be certainly something which is here to last in the end of the day. And then you mentioned AI. I think AI will be a super critical topic, because with AI, we have the opportunity to really rethink and reimagine business processes. And that goes way further than automation. I unfortunately so far see a lot of discussions about AI is just a kind of automation on steroids discussion. But I fundamentally do believe if we think AI in the right way, which means really thinking differently about our data and how we can use the data we have in our systems to really think differently about the process and leverage AI, then we get to new experience and new possibilities. And this is something what we need to rethink. And that's the reason why I believe to really invest also time in development, personal development with regards to AI certainly is always an important aspect. And another aspect, if you think about learning and skills, on top of mind is always security as well. I mean, the more complex the world will be, the more services we have on you know, various hyperscalers, various microservices. The complexity around security these days is for sure something where I also can just as one of a key topic, security, cybersecurity skills. I mean, you all know anyway, hot off the press or the market is certainly screaming for cybersecurity expertise as well. So also certainly a very exciting aspect around personal development as well. Yeah. But again, the good piece is there's on the one hand side stability, on the one hand side there's always changing technology, so it keeps always exciting, and then depending a little bit on your personal preference, you can develop. But I think that's the good with SAP. We have some stability, which is I think also very healthy.
Another question that just came in as well related to this. I'm an enthusiastic SAP developer, certified developer. Can you provide some more partner courses targeting us developers via open SAP platform to upskill our knowledge, please? And yes, we will take that to the learning organization. The community is actually part of Max Wessel's overall organization. We will take that one and send that over to the open SAP folks and everybody else as well. So absolutely, we will push to get you more inside those platforms. We have another question here at the top. When and how existing partners will get access to Signavio partner content, or will there be a separate partner agreement?
That's actually a good question, but I have to admit that I cannot answer that question right away. I will need to check back with the team how far we are with the partner alignment between Signavio and SAP. So very good context, and Deb, Greg, if you can ensure that we do the respective follow-up and give an answer, then
absolutely.
But I have to admit, I don't have the answer at hand, and I don't want to, you know, just openly admit I need to follow up where we stand with the partner agreement alignments between in the post-merger acquisition now integration of Signavio. Yeah. But we will do the follow-up. So this question is not lost.
I can tell you that from a community perspective, we are speaking to them from a community level about their involvement in coming into the SAP community, but it's very early stages. So, but we'll definitely do a follow up. Next question, API. Currently S4 on-prem APIs have been mentioned during DSAG keynote. What is the product strategy to improve and leverage the API hub with regards to S4 on-prem?
It's a very good question. And first of all, I want to address a little bit that question, but also extend it a little bit in general. Specifically for S4HANA on-premise, as you see, I think we now have 290 APIs on the API hub for also S4 on-premise. And we absolutely will and continue actually to provide open APIs in this regards on our API business hub. So first of all, that's absolutely strategic for us. And Jan Gilk, who's running S4 development in my area, he's even committed that for API requests, which we will receive, that we even get to, into a kind of an SLA in the direction of within 6 weeks that we deliver this API then on the API hub once we see the request. So certainly we want to accelerate that activity for sure in the cloud anyway, but also on premise, because for sure we absolutely do acknowledge the hybrid strategies of our customers, and we also have proudly significant amount of S4 customers also on premise, and that's the reason for sure we absolutely continue to invest into that area to optimize the extensibility for S4 in that direction. First of all, super strategic, we will continue. We even have now an accelerated SLA from Jan Gilg and his team to provide after request way more quickly the API to the community via the API hub. I think that's very important. And then for sure, what is a key aspect, and that's the reason why for sure some of the APIs there, we will not be able to provide every capability with an API, because an API has to promise that it's stable. I mean, that's the core foundation of an API, that you know that you have a stable core, which you can develop against in this interface. And for some of the areas, for sure, we have continuous developments on our own, which means we need to be super precise. What do we really open up as an API? Because we want to keep that stable for the next decade. And that's the reason we need to be sometimes in some areas very specific and diligent that we do it in the right way. But as a huge, tremendous uptick on APIs. In general, APIs is a key aspect. The same actually as events. And we want to add more events to all of our applications. And also here you see more events which we publish actually, which you then can subscribe to as well. That's also one of the key strategic activities. So APIs and events is actually the key notion here. And then for sure, what you also will see in order to have a more simpler way to extend is the notion around the one aligned data model on the business technology platform as well. And also here you will see a lot of positive traction, more announcements also at Sapphire, how we want to evolve it, because for us it's absolutely clear that this is the only way to go. Coming back to my original point, SAP needs to be open. I mean, we are always in a context and only one part of the puzzle piece. And that means we are absolutely aware that the openness of our systems is essential for our success. So we will continue to do that.
This goes back to when you were in the very beginning, and you were talking about our new chief design officer, Ben. And the question is what can we expect from this new CDO? And so I'm assuming that's the chief design officer.
Yeah, that's a good question. I mean, what we can expect is for sure that we absolutely want to push a lot in the way how much you can enjoy our software in the future. I think that is an important aspect, certainly what he has on the topic. But actually, to be quite frank, I mean, we will see the first result actually in an announcement that sounds Sapphire about our new mobile experience, where you will see a first glimpse of a kind of an elevated design possibilities, which we have, which is an evolution. Because, I mean, we have Fiori design system is the strategy, and we want to evolve that to a more fresh look, actually, what we want to do, more lightweight, simpler look, that it's easier to really handle it in a fresh way. You will see first glimpse there on Sapphire with the new mobile app, and that will then extend across the portfolio for sure. But also, rethinking about, for instance, how quickly do you get the task done? So we now measure way more diligently the number of clicks, the number of time a user actually needs to fulfill a task and to simplify that. That's for instance, also the reason why we want to get actionable buttons to the cards itself. That basically, if you have a dashboard, a Fiori launchpad, a central entry point across, by the way, the entire intelligent speed. Also, this is something which is on the way to come. But then when you have the respective cards, whatever that you have, whatever travel expense, that you directly have the key metrics, but can directly approve or reject, that you don't need to go into any inbox or that you don't need to jump into any detail, because we want to reduce the amount of clicks with a way more fresh approach. And that's where he's coming in a different manner. Definitely bringing way more metrics into the game. So we will use the Google's Google Hearts framework around how to measure the enjoyment and happiness and all of the various aspects, but with clear metrics, really metrics how we want to drive the user experience by each product and together, and also being able to benchmark that better. So there will be a lot of things. So I think that is an important piece. And quite frankly, what he will have on his charter is the cultural change for SAP to be more user-centric. I think that is a key aspect. So user research, user centricity is a key aspect. And I mean, I'm here among experts. You all know that sometimes SAP is too much focused on the process itself and not focusing on the human being behind. As I mentioned, in the end of the day, it's not about the application itself. It's about to get the job done. And that's also the reason how we want to actually humanize a little bit the software. This will be a key aspect. And this for sure starts also with a cultural change within the development teams, to be quite frank. And there will also be a lot of push in that. And then for sure, yes, designers, yes, user researchers, to really drive that topic to the next level. We also certainly invest, and that's where I'm very proud. For instance, also with regards to mixed reality, we will see more mixed reality cases with augmented reality and virtual reality cases for SAP itself. There's a lot of topics on the horizon in the various solution areas, actually. So yeah, I expect that we will see definitively a new push and a lot of freshness into that topic, how SAP will then be hopefully perceived in the future. So more to come. And again, I would really recommend even a community call with Ben. It's I think that would be super, super helpful also to get your feedback, that he directly can listen to your feedback right away. I think it would be superb. Yeah.
Our SAP mentors have met with Ben already and they've been quite excited about that. But yeah, I would have to say I definitely think we should reach out to Ben and see if he would be coming able and willing to come onto an open call like this, for everybody to ask their feedback and provide it as well.
Just to give you some context about Ben, and you see, I'm super excited that I could convince him to come to SAP. He came from a German startup, Wunderlist, and Wunderlist, the app was actually considered as the best user experience from an app perspective back in the time. And that was the reason why actually Microsoft bought them. That was his way to Microsoft, but then he basically revitalized Office 365 design. So he certainly brings that aspects of a startup and the pure design competency to the corporate world, and to the complexity to bring multiple products like, you know, I mean, Word, Outlook, Excel, whatever. This is all different products, as you know, to bring that together. So he has a lot of, so the perfect combination actually for SAP to help us in a realistic manner, to have the highest impact actually what we want to achieve, because it's also clear that we need to evolve SAP. It's not that we can now disrupt and do something entirely different and it will not work. I mean, we talked before about SAP UI5 and S4HANA. I mean, some of you will know the number of screens we have with S4HANA and now enabled with SAP UI5. Certainly something which we certainly cannot throw away. Let's phrase it like that. There was a tremendous effort the last years. And I think that's important for SAP. We need to be able to evolve, but in the most impactful way. That's actually. And there, I think it helps to have this very metric-driven way as well to see how we can improve it for the customer. Yeah.
The next question, this is from Rafi. Hello, Mr. Thomas. My name is Rafi Hafizes, sir. I'm so sorry with the last name there, from Indonesia. I'm an undergraduate. I want to know how SAP's strategy to be used by all companies that have different business processes. I'm not sure you could talk about the entire strategy related to this, but maybe highlight a couple of areas of how we're dealing with the different combination of business processes.
I think if I understand the question correctly, and Rafi, please correct me if I'm wrong, but actually I believe what is the basis of the question is, in the end of the day, we have standard software and the strategy to become an intelligent enterprise, and we have kind of, you know, best practice process enabled, for instance, for lead to cash, for hire to retire, for source to pay and the likes. But for sure, you have in every company itself differentiated ways of the processes, and for sure you also have highly differentiated capabilities where companies differentiate. And that's absolutely the point. And actually multiple aspects. The first is it's important. Yes, we deliver best practice content and best practice processes, but for sure the configuration and flexibility to adjust is a key aspect. And that's what you can do with the configuration itself. Then you can extend the solutions with in-app extensibility or with side-by-side extensibility with the business technology platform. And again, leveraging, coming to the other question, the APIs and the events we provide, the domain model to be able to do your own differentiated applications on top, to be able to really differentiate those. Actually, that's what SAP is actually about. That yes, we provide standard best practice processes, but in a highly extensible fashion that you can differentiate, and that's a very important notion as well. So certainly not one size fits all, but certainly it's a good starting point to then tweak it to your needs. And that's what we see actually in all of the implementations for our customers, that for sure they bring in that differentiation with the extensibility we can provide as well.
Kind of tag on to that, I'm going to skip one question and go to this one that just got submitted because I think it's a little bit related. This was submitted anonymously. It's regarding better experiences. Are there tools built into SAP's products that help deployment teams track, optimize adoption and use, iteratively adapt it to new user needs, et cetera? And I think that goes to what you were just talking about learning from it. And
one of the aspects, or I think this question also tackles multiple aspects, because with regards to tracking the adoption and the usage, for sure, I mean, there are usage frameworks which you can leverage. And I think that's a very important aspect, and to really analyze the usage of your products which you build. And then for sure, on top of that, there's always the possibility. And for instance, we see the first glimpses in S4HANA Cloud, and we put it across the entire portfolio, that we basically embed in this regards also Qualtrics to get direct end user feedback to the teams. And that's certainly something I can absolutely encourage everybody to really use the product experience part of Qualtrics in the product itself. To really get the real end user feedback and with that also the needs in the respective transaction or application which you build it, and with that can continuously optimize it. And here we also include in this regards for our SAP products in this survey also a standardized framework to track the user experience rating, that we can really manage and see the improvement of what we do from the real end user itself. Certainly an important aspect. And as mentioned, a lot of telemetry metrics and usage measurement is built in our products. And that's what we actually use to optimize the products as well.
Back to this question from Jasper. SAP are working hard for sustainable innovation and how BTP go for a business strategy that is sustainable. Need one example for any SAP product area where technology is helping business to move towards sustainability, and how we are planning more on that areas for future.
Well, one of the greatest examples, what we just actually released, we will actually release a product on the business technology platform, fully built business technology platform, is actually how to steer holistically the business, which means that you basically have all these ESG dimensions for sustainability, like all the environmental one, the societal one, and the governance topics, and how to track that in an engine. And that's what we actually do. Because also, if you think about the steering, this is something which goes across the portfolio. That's the reason why BTP was the perfect vehicle actually to do that. And we also provide, for instance, now a calculation engine for product carbon footprint also on the business technology platform, which we have. Another good example for business technology platform is our product, which we released last year, the SAP product footprint carbon analytics, which is leveraging the SAP analytics cloud actually to really analyze the carbon footprint. And quite frankly, this is the foundation, the basis to really optimize and minimize the carbon footprint in the second step. So that's certainly a very important aspect. So you see basically there's a ton of activities all around the business technology platform, With regards to that, and actually our development head for sustainability is Gunter Roth-Emmel, and a couple of you will know him because he was running also the business technology platform, the SAP Cloud platform back in the time called in the past. So he's all over the platform. So rest assured, that's the foundation of what we do with sustainability. But also, quite frankly, just to add another sustainability aspect is we don't start from scratch, quite frankly, because sustainability is something we do since basically a decade. And we have even more than two decades ago started with the first product, which is EH&S, Environment, Health and Safety as a product, which is also one of the dimensions of sustainability. So certainly SAP is there really already very active, but for sure we really doubled down now on this activity from this perspective. And again, in all of our products, if you think about procurement and sourcing, if you think about travel and travel, I mean, travel is all over CO2 and how we can directly offset actually travel footprint which you accumulate. If you think about HR with diversity and inclusion, so it's certainly across across what we do. And also let me add one angle when we just talk about sustainability. SAP itself wants for sure also to be a best exemplar in this regards. And we for sure not only pride ourselves that the last 14 years we were always on road the number one company in the Dow Jones Sustainability Index as the best sustainable company. But also we this year decided to accelerate our ambition to become carbon neutral by 2023. And I think that's also a bold move. And I hope that a lot of customers will follow that example. And I think really topic dear to my heart, as you see, but I truly believe it is key for us that we help here in this regards.
Probably one of our last questions, and we're getting close to the top of the hour. This one is from Srinivasa. What are the emerging industries SAP is focusing on? What are the technologies modules offered by SAP to cater to these demands?
With regards to industries, we last year launched the SAP Industry Cloud. And that's actually the foundation of that is for sure the experience in 25 industries for more than four decades, actually. And that's the reason why SAP always was looking into industries and for industry-specific processes. And now for sure, we also want to double down in the cloud in this regards. And in the cloud, in the SAP Industry Cloud, which is also fully based again on business technology platform, the key concept is for sure openness to invite more partners in the ecosystem to join together with us, drive the innovation in the respective industry verticals, what we see, which means from our focus, we have 25 industries, always depend on how you count the industries and how you define the sectors, but that's the rough order of magnitude. And there for sure we are active. We have a couple of focus industries where SAP itself is really doubling down on certain aspects. You saw a lot of announcements around what we do in the automotive sector, in retail, consumer products, in IM&C, in manufacturing in general. So there's certainly a lot of traction. But actually what is interesting for the industry topic is what we actually see in the market is that the lines of industries are blurring. So for instance, based on the business model change of a lot of companies, we see a lot of tremendous demand with regards to consumption-based billing as one of the examples, which we see now in many, many industries. We actually have for sure the market leading product with our Prim solution. And this was for sure in the past always very focused on telco and utilities. But now this capability consumption-based billing is actually now center stage in media, in high tech, basically everywhere. So we now actually think differently with regards to business capabilities, which had an industry specific starting point perhaps. But as the lines are blurring and the business models evolve, we can cross-leverage actually certain business capabilities across the industries and instead help to accelerate the transformation. That's what we certainly do very, very actively in this regard. So I think that's a very important notion as well, that we think differently here. And so SAP is definitely with full focus on industry specific topics. And also, as mentioned, if you think about Industry 4.0 manufacturing, if you think about how the digital factory works, the digital thread of a product end to end. I mean, this is all the topics which we are all over together with partners to help our customers succeed. And yeah, also here, more announcement on these topics on Sapphire. So for instance, with regards to Microsoft and what we do with Edge and others certainly come. So a lot of teasers, I guess, for Sapphire. a lot of goodness coming. But there's a lot of things what we delivered this year, and we are really proud to share that. And that's, I mean, coming back to the beginning, I think we did a tremendous amount of work and also a lot of groundwork last year. And this year you will see the positive benefits, which actually will turn out into a firework of innovation this year based on what we did together with our partners. So I'm really excited, and I hope you will share that excitement after the final announcements at Sapphire. And having said that, I think, Craig, we are on top of the hour, unfortunately. But again, really appreciate again that you took the time. I appreciated all the questions. We have some follow-ups to do. We will do so. Please rest assured on that one. So thanks so much for taking the time. And Craig and team, thanks so much for organizing the call. And I'm already looking forward to the next one together with you. So thank you so much. It's really, really dear to me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Thomas, very much. Thank you, everyone, for participating. The recordings will be available shortly online, and we will follow up with those simple questions in blog posts or something, or future calls within the SAP community as well. So thank you, everyone. Have a great rest of your day. Stay safe and stay healthy.